everybody. Sorry for the hold up. Had some disputes with the venue. No, I had to put the blinds up. I forgot. So today I'm going to do music from the 20s to the 10s, hopefully. It's not going to be particularly relevant selection. It's a bit random, really. some things that I thought I should put in, some things that I wanted to put in, etc., etc. So, don't at me, as they say, if your tune doesn't get in, whatever that tune is. I'm just trying to read the... glasses. I've lost my glasses again. Never mind. So, I'm just going to start with one. Bob Hope and Wayne Shorter. Some people will know who one is and some people will know who the other is.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was thanks for the memory. I can't remember who wrote it, and it seemed like a good tune to start with because it's a kind of standard jazz tune. So the sort of procedure of doing it is a little bit more straightforward. But as usual, when the procedure is a bit more straightforward, the detail kind of gets more complicated. So yeah, I just basically learnt that tune recently. The first time I heard it was on a record called 8:30 by Weather Report, who most people will know are a kind of, I suppose, what you'd call a fusion band. They're all originally played a more orthodox form of jazz and then got into fusing kind of African music, synthesizers, electronics and stuff like that, Brazilian music. And Wayne Shorter does a solo version of that tune on the album 8:30 that I've always really, really loved. So that's kind of why I did it. It's not the Bob Hope tune that that I love particularly, but Wayne Shorter's version of it. And I always wanted to have that kind of approach to music, like take something from any time and play it the way you want to play it, which is what Wayne Shorter has always done. So rather than go chronologically from the 20s to the 10s, I'm going to dart around a bit. These are all kind of tunes that I've either really liked listening to or really liked discovering, some more recently than others. So that was thanks for the memory. Now I'm going to do something from the 80s. And I already did 80s pop, but this was a tune that I used to play a lot with a singer called Jenny Darren. Some musicians here might know her. And a bass player called Jeff Gascoigne, who played electric bass then, and Mark Fletcher playing drums. And we used to do this gig in a hotel, and we used to play this tune, Sweet Love, all the time. And playing this tune was one of the ways I learned how to play music that wasn't jazz rhythmically well, so that it grooved or swung. I don't know if I'm going to do that today. So yeah, this is Sweet Love by Anita Baker. And I'm going to play it from memory because I think I know it. Here goes. Thank you. Thank you. Whenever you go for these quiet ones down the bottom, they never come out, and then they go like that suddenly. Better that they don't come out than they do that. So, yeah, that was Sweet Love. Go and check out the record. There's a thing about this kind of music that kind of comes out of jazz, but comes out of African music. This thing about trying to play grooves. And Prince, whose music I'm going to do a bit of later, is another. There are several people that are really good at doing that. And I thought about what it is that makes something groove. And I was thinking about what it's like when you tickle a baby. Now, if you tickle a baby and you go like this, straight away they laugh. But if you keep doing that, eventually they get bored. But the thing is, when you kind of go like this, and then you don't tickle them, and they're waiting for you to do it, and they're laughing, and then when they actually get tickled, it's more intense. And playing grooves is like that for me. It's like leaving space, and people that do it really well make you wait, like Miles Davis will wait, make you wait for one note. And these kind of band, like Anita Baker's band on this record, Rapture, that I used to listen to all the time, it was like a kind of offshoot of jazz, but it had a lot of jazz chords in it. But instead of playing solos and loads of notes, you had to really think about where exactly you would put four notes that are all supposed to be the same length, and they sound the same length, but they're not. So. Anyway, I could ramble on about this for ages. Maybe I'll talk a bit more about it when Prince comes up and some other people. So, let me read some of these messages. Get my breath back. Hello, everybody. Great, thank you all for coming. Lots of people. Chat pause due to scroll. Thanks, Guy. Pure poetry, yeah. I spent a long time thinking about that one. Well, I spent a lot of time tickling babies as well as trying to play that kind of music. So, the next one I'm going to do, no, I'm going to wait for that. I had one, but I've changed everything around. So I'm going to go to the 40s now. What I remember about the 40s is, well, nothing, obviously, but I think I was on holiday with my parents. If my mum's here, she might be able to correct me, but she won't be able to sign in to this thing, so it won't happen live, but maybe some other time. I think we were in Cornwall. We turned up to this house, and there were records in the house, and one that they had was Glenn Miller's Greatest Hits, and that was one of the things that kind of got me into the sort of jazz line of music, I suppose, was getting into that big band sound. And I remember there was Little Brown Jug and String of Pearls are the two that I remember most. So I was going to have a go at String of Pearls, because people don't really play it, because there's not really much to it, but so many people know the tune that I thought I might try and do it. Tim Haley. Hello, Tim Haley. What's the tipple? The tipple is Brewdog Vagabond. It's actually today's broadcast sponsored by gluten-free beer. Get smashed without bloating and sickness and feel good about yourself. I don't know why. Anyway, there was only one left in the fridge, so I can't chart the effects of large doses of consumption. So, this is possibly String of Pearls. Thank you. you. Yeah, that was String of Pearls by Glenn Miller. It's one of those tunes. I listened to it again, and there's so much stuff in the arrangement that's so specific that I thought was improvised at the time. And I keep hearing the actual record and wanting to do all the things on the record, and then so I deliberately didn't learn them to avoid playing them, which was good. Yes. So now I'm going to try and do something from the 2010s. I'm going to dedicate this tune to my son Joe, who I think is here, because I think I saw his emoticon with little photos of a kid. I think it's a friend of his at school. Yeah, so he put me onto this. I got one of the things that happens that I found happening to me is that all the music I like is old. It's all when I was young. And sometimes you have to make a bit of an effort to kind of keep your ears open for things that are happening in the sort of contemporary music world that are still interesting or pique your interest, as it were. And Joe, I was asking him what he listened to, and he told me about this guy, Declan McKenna. Now, I don't know how this is going to go, because I've listened to the song a few times, and I've written down a kind of transcription of it, so it's going to be pretty vague. I'm just going to leave this. Would you like to live in a piano world? Says Luca. Yes. Actually, I would. But it's one of those things, careful what you wish for kind of things. I think you think you want to live in a piano world, but then after a while you want to go back to the world of other things, inferior though it may be. Yeah, so I don't know about a piano world. I only need one, really, to keep me going. One is hard enough. So anyway, this is a song called Isombard by Declan McKenna. And I think it's only about a year old. And he's about like 3 years old or something, I don't know, 15, 16, maybe he's 18 now. But he was like a kid, you know, and I made the mistake of going on online and looking at interviews with him, and I kind of thought, oh, you know, it's like precocious little kid, you know. But actually, when I heard the song, I got to admit, I liked it. I liked the notes, you know. In the end, you just got to hope that people are pushing notes around in an interesting way. And I think he is in this song. So this is Isombard. I'm going to give it a shot. Dedicated to Joe. Thank you. Thank you. That was Isombard. So, Declan, you know where I am. Come on, give us a gig. Well, when there are gigs or recordings or, you know, chat shows. Can I have a chat show?
Yeah.
So, thank you. So that was Isombard. Now I'm going to do something from the 20s. How did you do that so well? There you go. That's it, Joe. Go on. Keep going. Say nice things. Yeah, I don't know. I thought about it a lot. And I've been doing it too long, this stuff. So maybe that's how. But thank you. That's it's good when you get compliments off your own kids. Or anyone else's kids, actually. If anyone else's kids are here, everybody's someone's kid. So, yeah, moving on. I'm gabbling. I was talking to somebody today and said, if we do this online gig, we've got to keep it snappy because everybody just gasses on online. I'm like, how the hell? Ow. So, I'm trying to get in some of the musicians that I've and composers that have inspired me. But there are logistical problems with this. One is that I don't really have that much time to practice, and if I did have much time to practice, I still wouldn't be able to play a lot of the things. But this is a piece by Stravinsky, and I was so happy when I looked it up on Wikipedia and it said it was written in 1921. It's like just snagged in, because it's a bit like Bartok Microcosmos. It's kind of written for children, so it's like written for, has to be said, quite precocious, kind of curious kids, I would say. Instead of having to play jelly on a plate and all that kind of stuff, I dream of Genie with the light brown hair, whatever that is. That's quite a nice tune. So Stravinsky wrote this piece called Les Cinq Doits, which in my immaculate French accent you will recognise as the five fingers, which are these. And the other thing about this piece is that it's written all on C major scale, which is all the white notes. And normally when you learn about C major scale at school, it's like there's C major, and there's F major, and there's G major. Now go and write a top 10 hit and buy a villa in the south of France. You know, so a lot of chords. Actually, Declan McKenna. But there are also other ways of playing all the white notes. You could, for example, go like that. That's a bit over the top. But there are other sounds. Whenever I go to demonstrate them, they never come out. But there are other sounds that use those very simple notes. They're basically like kind of wrong notes, I suppose. Wrong in inverted commas. So I'm going to attempt the second piece of this. It still looks quite tricky. Let's see if I get it right. I might even put my glasses on. So I'm going to play it, and then I might kind of improvise a bit afterwards. I'm going to try and stay in C major. Some of your gas is most instructive. Yeah, I left the gas on. So here we go. The Five Fingers, part two. Right. Thank you. cue. Timani. Yes, I agree about the Soldier's Tale. It's very similar. It's kind of got that strange overlapping rhythms, things. Also, it's a very Russian kind of sounding music. Nobody else was doing that kind of thing. So that's the bit of Stravinsky that I can play. but I've listened to tons and tons and tons and tons of it. That's why I've got him up there. So there's Stravinsky on one side. On the other side is Duke Ellington, who I'm going to do next. I'm going to do him. I'm going to do Duke Ellington. That process. Now, the interesting thing about Ellington, as with Stravinsky actually, is that I could have picked 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s. He was active in all of those decades. And I thought what would be interesting, first of all, I wanted to try something that I've never played of his before. So I picked this tune from the 70s called Chinoiserie, which I heard really early on. I used to have a tape at school of Duke Ellington live on one side and Stravinsky, Rite of Spring and Symphony of Psalms on the other side. And I used to listen to this on a Walkman round and round. And I think I've said this before in some of my many interviews, that the two things, if you listen to two things close together for long enough, they start sounding like they came out of the same pod, or that they're related somehow. So that's what happened to me. So I got interested in how Ellington uses the piano and how Stravinsky uses the piano, which is as a kind of an instrument that doesn't do that much in the context of a group, but when it does, it really jumps out of the ensemble. This is quite a simple tune, Chinoiserie. It's also written about Marshall McLuhan's statement, apparently, that the whole in the future the whole world will basically be Oriental. And I know Oriental is a kind of derogatory kind of term now, but this was in the 60s, I think. So he'd written this tune called Chinoiserie. And actually, I guess nobody could predict the kind of economic power that China has now. Anyway, I'm not going to get into that discussion because at this point I realise I don't know anything. So stick to music, mate. So this is Chinoiserie by Duke Ellington, written in 1972. He must have spent about 50 years pretty much non-stop gigging on the road all that time. Remember when there was a road to go on? We used to say when there were gigs to do. Now you can't even really go on the road, let alone do the gig at the end of it. So here is Chinoiserie. Thank you. Thank you. That was Chinoiserie. You can in Durham. No, I can't see the question that you can in Durham is the answer to. I'm missing something. Thank you. There are these long pauses where I'm reading the thingy. So that was Chinoiserie. I would like to do now, looking for time, great, something from the 50s, again, like the 20s, the 50s is peak time for jazz, but I thought I would do something different, and I'm going to dedicate this tune to Luca, who is, I think, my youngest fan. I think he's 6. I could be wrong about that. 6 is my estimate. But I'm going to dedicate this to him because it's a piece by a Catalan composer, Frederic Mompou. And he wrote these tiny little pieces. This is a series of pieces called Musica, Callada. And a lot of it has a kind of bell-like quality, but they're very short. And I don't know if you can see, but at the end of the music, this is, I don't know if this looks backwards to you or not, but you can see where the music ends. There's no bar line, which kind of suggested to me a kind of improvisatory thing, like he finishes it, but it's not really the end. He doesn't see it as the end of the piece. It's just like a thing that drifts in and out. And I always really loved these pieces. So I'm going to have a go at playing this. This is the second piece in Musica Callada. If anybody knows Catalan, they might be able to tell me what that means. But I don't know. And his pieces always have this thing where there's a kind of mysterious sound about it, and then he kind of suddenly does something really rich in the middle, which feels really good. It's a bit like the tickling thing again, but with harmony. And he sort of makes you wait for the nice chord. It's very clever. So this is Musica Callada Part 2. The Revenge. It's like Jaws 2. Think of it like that, but a lot smaller. Thank you. Thank you. Silent music. Yeah, it is. It is very nearly silent. Yeah, a lot of his tunes are very quiet. So yeah, that was F.Mompou. I'd never heard of him, and then I got a CD in Mull Jazz, in the old days of Mull Jazz record shop in King's Cross, and it was on ECM. I just bought everything on ECM, the record label ECM at the time. And I got it home and I thought, oh, this isn't jazz, it's kind of like Ravel or something. But it's different to Ravel. There's a lot less in it. It's a lot thinner. It's a lot easier to play. Thank you. So now I've got two more tunes to do. What did I miss now? Oh no, I've got three more tunes. Haven't done the 60s. Burt Bacharach. Thank you. thanks. That was Alfie, written by Burt Bacharach and Hal David for the tune Alfie. For the tune Alfie? It was a tune written for the tune. For the film Alfie, which I think Cilla Black... No, Cher sings it at the end of the film. So it doesn't really come up in the film, but it's just at the end. Yeah, but great tune. Burt Bacharach, amazing writer. Now I'm going to do a tune by... This is one of these tunes. I got obsessed with this Prince record, the one that's called the Love Symbol record that's got no title. Prince is a kind of divisive sort of figure. I think people love or hate the kind of persona of him and the kind of image and the kind of bollocks in a way that goes along with him. But I think there's a lot of humour in it. And this record, the Love Symbol album, he does a lot of real arrogant posturing sort of songs, but they're just really I think they're really funny. I think he's taken a mick. But the thing about him is that he's a consummate musician. I mean, I find with every Prince album, there's like two or three tunes that I don't particularly like, and then there's two or three on every single album that are incredible because of the way that he puts things together. And this tune is called Love You to the Nines, and on the face of it, it's kind of like a Jackson 5 parody almost. It sounds very much like that Jackson 5 sound, and he does the quite squeaky Michael Jackson singing voice. But then there's a bit in the middle of it, the chorus, and the way that he makes the chords move, the way the notes move is just incredible, and the way that it's arranged. So I've always wanted to know what it was, and I've never really kind of got round to finding out, and I still don't know if I've got it right. But that's my reason for playing it. It's my obsession with the middle of this song. So, here we go. Prince, Love You to the Nines. He's also a master of the baby tickling rhythm thing. The way that he layers different ideas on top of each other is like, it's. You always get the feeling he's got the perfect thing. He's done it the perfect way. So here we go. Thank you. Prince, whose estate are shortly to be phoning me, either to offer me some work or to completely destroy me financially. Some would say, as a jazz musician, those two things are exactly the same. Okay, so my last tune. Wow, it's late. PJ Harvey. So we're now in the 2000s. PJ Harvey was, I can honestly say, the first person I heard playing kind of guitar indie type music, I suppose you would call it. I sound really old now. Yeah, she was the first band I heard. I heard her on Jules Holland, actually. And I was just completely knocked out by her sort of energy, and the whole thing just seemed to kind of jump out somehow. Like, music either jumps out or it doesn't to me. And the first album I've got of hers was called Stories from the City, Stories from the Sea, which won the Mercury Award. So it was also the first time I bought a record that anybody else liked. And one of my favourite tunes on that is a piece called Horses in My Dreams. So this is it. Horses in My Dreams. Thank you all for coming. And yeah, see you next week, hopefully. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, that's it for today. So next week I'm doing 100 years starting in the 12th century, 1220. No, I'm not. I'm actually not going to do that. It's too hard or too weird. RPG. Ah, Marco and... Where's my glasses? I know it's Marco and I can't ever read. Marco Naya. Thank you for the PJ Harvey vote of confidence. Yeah, I think she's great. Really worth checking out. And thank you all for coming. See you next week. Yes, where I'll be doing God knows what. Schoenberg, Tom and Jerry, I don't know. I'll have a think. Thank you very much. See you next week.